Madoka Magica, which was a show criticizing girls for having aspirations in Greece. I actually really like the first season of Madoka Magica because somehow it still has an empowering message, despite the creator's intent to shame girls for having aspirations beyond just staying in the kitchen. In the previous video I made talking about Magical Girl Friendship Squad, I had a brief mention of the creator of Madoka Magica, as I put it, intent behind the show. And I mentioned in the video that the creator's intent on Madoka Magica was to shame girls for having aspirations, where the quote that I read was that having aspirations and goals inherently will cause suffering. And I had a few people, more than one person, asking me to elaborate on this. Not nastily, they were just honestly interested. And what I thought was, okay, well, I don't want my channel to become like a magical girl focused channel, even though it's something I really like and it's something I'm passionate about. I don't want that to be the sole focus. I basically want to just talk about whatever I want kind of thing, you know. I'm a big archaeology nerd, so maybe at some point I'll be like, oh, this is a cool book that I really like by a cool historian that you guys should read. I don't want to just be like, oh, magical girls and shoujo, like, all the time on every single video. But more than one person asked me to elaborate on this because they found it interesting and they hadn't heard this before. So what I thought I would do is I would just make like a quick 5-minute video talking about, oh, this is what the creator, quote unquote, the creator said. And then I would move on to another topic because there are some things I want to talk about. I've been wanting to make a video explaining the importance of the Rose of Versailles anime for like 2 years now. Which I only started making videos recently, but like I said before, I tend to psych myself out. I'm also thinking of making a video on like the live action Sailor Moon series because I haven't seen a single person talk about that series like in a YouTube video. So I had these ideas of things I want to do, but I wanted to just kind of elaborate on this and then be like, okay, well, this is what I was talking about, and then move on. So that was the plan, and I went online to find the source material so that I could read the direct quote, like this is what the creator said. And as I was looking for the direct quote to use and quote in the video, I started having trouble, and I kept on looking, and there are quite a lot of interviews with Gen Urobuchi, that's the writer's name. There are quite a lot of interviews with him because he didn't only work on Madoka Magica, he's actually quite well known for other anime as well. He's the lead writer for Maho Shoujo Lyrical Nanoha, which is another like quote-unquote mature magical girl show. And he worked on like Psycho Pass and things like that. So there are a lot of interviews out with him. And I read quite a few of them and I could not find the source quote of him saying this. And, you know, then you start like, okay, well, maybe it wasn't him, maybe it was the director, and maybe it was somebody else, maybe it was one of the manga writers, maybe, you know, so I start looking. And what I found was, I'm not going crazy, because I actually found several people online asking about the same interview. Obviously, there are people on Tumblr talking about this, which is where I heard this originally, but I was finding threads on, like, Reddit of people asking for this interview, if anybody knew where to find it. And people on Twitter were tweeting about it, asking, does anybody know about this infamous interview with Gen Urobuchi? Gen Urobuchi. they were looking for this interview by Gen Urobuchi, where he said, quote unquote, a lot of sexist things. And the consensus seemed to be that everybody points to this one interview done in 2011 with the writer Gen Urobuchi in a Japanese newspaper. And only the first paragraph of this interview was translated, like, quote-unquote, officially by Anime News Network. And the part that they translated was a section where Gen Urobuchi compared magical girls to Al-Qaeda. And that was kind of the catchy clickbait headline was, Gen Urobuchi compares magical girls, Madoka Magica, to Al-Qaeda. And that was the part that got officially translated. As an aside, Anime News Network, if you're going to report on something, just report on it. Don't hide it behind white text and say, oh, it's because of spoilers, when you don't do that with any other spoiler content. Like, come on, either report on something or don't. But anyway, that was the big highlight, was Gen Urobuchi compared Magical Girls to Al-Qaeda. And the rest of the interview was apparently translated independently by a blog who had the Japanese transcript of the newspaper, and then the person behind the blog translated the rest of it. And people were saying on Reddit and Twitter that the reason people thought that Gen Urobuchi said sexist things regarding magical girls and shaming girls for having ambitions and such came from a mistranslation of the interview. So I actually read the interview. I went to find the blog. It took a little digging, but somebody eventually brought it up. And I read the full interview as translated by this blog. I also went and found newer translations of the same interview from the same magazine to compare. But even if we just go by what the blog itself, who reported on this initially and independently translated the interview, said, this is what is actually said between an interviewer and Gen Urobuchi, the writer for Madoka Magica.
I paid attention to the aspects that are troubling or overlooked in the traditional magical girl genre. I've been thinking that magical girls who have acquired superhuman abilities will find themselves removed from the world, which would cause contradictions and reactions.
Magical girls, who are full of hope and who strive to save the people, soon suffer from hatred and jealousy, which turn them into the enemy witches. The change from good to evil left an emotional impact.
For example, Al-Qaeda brought down the Twin Towers due to their self-righteousness. Justice for some people is an evil for others. Good intentions, kindness, and hope will not necessarily make people happy.
In the climax of the series, witches bring a disaster upon the city. Isn't it that in modern society, people's negative emotions are what destroys the world?
One curse brings about another, creating a cycle of hatred. That's what I find the most terrifying. Positive words like happiness, victory and glory are only spoken after being thrown into the same trash can with their opposites. Even if it starts smelling or maggots get out, we pretend not to notice and paint the world in bright colors.
So, it seems we have a bit of a broken telephone situation. What was happening was Gen Urobuchi was commentating on the nature of good and evil and how evil acts can be done by people who think they are in the right and who think what they are doing is actually motivated by pure and good intentions. And that as a result, people who might actually be considered good people will end up hurting others. And this ties into the entire theme of Madoka Magica regarding witches and the magical girls who have to destroy witches who feed on negative emotions. I'm going to go into a bit of spoiler territory regarding Madoka Magica's main plot and especially about how it ends and all the revelations. So if you have not seen Madoka Magica, I do actually recommend it. It's 12 episodes for the original show and just watch it from start to finish. It's not that long and I think it is worth a watch. So with the spoiler warning out of the way, Gen Urobuchi's commentating on how good people can think they are doing good things, even though they end up hurting others, ties into this idea of magical girls who fight witches and the eventual revelation we learn in the show, where it turns out that magical girls who hunt witches eventually become tainted by emotions like grief and despair and become witches themselves, who then go on to hurt others. So him comparing magical girls to Al-Qaeda, that's what he was saying, is you have people who believe themselves to be in the right and then do terrible things. But what happened here is people saw the clickbait headline comparing magical girls to like Al-Qaeda, and they took that as Gen Urobuchi saying that magical girls are in the wrong for their actions, as if saying, well, magical girls are wrong for doing the things magical girls do. And then this got further sort of mixed up into magical girls are wrong for being magical girls, which at some point ended up on the final conclusion that magical girls like the Magical Girls of Madoka Magica is a commentary on how girls should not have ambitions because it will only end up hurting them. So it's this very long broken telephone situation of one person said this, and then the next person said this, and then the next person said this. And then as a result, people were also saying the interview is poorly translated. It's not actually translated that poorly if I compare it to other translations, so I'm not entirely sure where the idea that the interview is poorly translated came from. It might be, but if I just look at other translations, it's not that far off in its translation. But now the thing is, right, I can understand, especially if you're an American, how just mentioning Al-Qaeda out of nowhere is like kind of a, you know, it's kind of like a pinprick that immediately makes you jump and sit up and pay attention. Like, I'm sorry, what? So I can understand this idea of, well, why mention Al-Qaeda? Why go to, you know, number 99 when comparing Madoka Magica to something? Why jump to that to compare it, right? And then Urobuchi, in the same interview, he goes on to say this about nuclear power.
It seems those troubled days will never end.
There is no absolute justice and no absolute conclusion. In the anime series, there is a scene where one magical girl argues that by trusting in hope, you only bring about equally strong despair. The world is made to keep its final balance at zero. Even if we chase after hope, despair is sure to follow. We must be willing to accept this from the beginning. To make something purer, we have to throw out the oil used. It is impossible to create something beautiful without producing waste matter in the process.
The nuclear reactors, which were supposed to bring us abundant life, now spread radioactive material. Desires which go against logic bring about distortions. This anime line sounds like a fitting aphorism for this situation.
Now everyone goes on and on about saving electricity, but we should have thought about a world which doesn't require such dangerous things to be built in the first place. I thought we were aware of the risk of radioactive pollution when we wished for the brilliant Christmas illuminations.
So, reading this, it comes across as like needlessly edgy, right? If you were to look at Madoka Magica, which is, you know, this dark magical girl show, it's not the first one. I think Lyrical Nanoha actually beats it out for that. Although, you know, even Sailor Moon had some pretty hardcore situations and stuff in that show. But regardless, Madoka Magica is kind of like the one people can point at and say this is where magical girls started going really grimdark. If you compare that to like just bringing up Al-Qaeda out of nowhere and like these really, really descriptive and emotively charged words about nuclear power, it comes across as like needlessly edgy, right? I mean, why even bring up stuff like that? Why even bring this up while you're talking about an anime about middle school girls like suffering horribly, right? Why bring this up? Maho Shoujo Madoka Magica, or as it was retitled later, Magi Puella Madoka Magica, started airing on the 7th of January 2011. On the 11th of March that same year, a 9.1 earthquake hit northern Japan. The earthquake caused a massive tsunami that destroyed much of the coastal cities, resulting in 15,899 reported deaths, 6,157 injured, and 2,529 people still reported missing to this day. The earthquake caused another major disaster, resulting in the core meltdown of the Fukushima power plant. The entire surrounding population had to be evacuated, and the area is still deemed unsafe with dangerous levels of radioactivity, the core itself still being monitored regularly. Only recently have certain expeditions by photographers gone to show the aftermath of the ongoing disaster. Many of Japan's population blamed the government for not reacting to the disaster in time, tied up in red tape and meetings as the death toll continued to rise. This anger and dismay became so synonymous with the event that the 2019 movie Shin Godzilla's main plot was about government inadequacy as disaster ravages the country, just as Godzilla in the 1954's main plot was about the long-lasting wound caused by the Hiroshima and Nagasaki bombings. A large part of Japan's culture is deeply rooted in the instability of its own existence. In its folklore, it has stories of Namazu, the great earth-shaking catfish trapped by a large boulder, whose thrashing causes the ground to shake. Japan is a country with a history of great cataclysmic disasters, whose presence echoes in its fiction both deliberately and indirectly. The 2011 earthquake halted production of Madoka Magica for a while. On September 7th, 2011, Anime News Network had an interview with Madoka's director, Atsuhiro Iwakami.
The last two episodes were delayed due to the March 11th earthquake. Can you talk about that experience? What was it like in the studio at that time?
The studio had been making each episode on an ongoing basis, exactly on schedule for broadcast, so there was never any room for disruptions. After the earthquake, some staff members were very shaken. Even if the TV station had said that they would go ahead with the regular broadcast schedule, we probably wouldn't have been ready. But a week went by, and 2 weeks went by, and the staff started saying that they couldn't stay in shock forever, that they had to keep on going, and then production continued.
The series ends by demonstrating that through selflessness, people can get through difficult situations. Does that idea hold a stronger meaning now, seeing everyone working together after the earthquake?
That synchronicity with reality wasn't something that was planned, but I did feel that, as a member of the viewership.
Despite the title of the show, Madoka herself does not choose to become a magical girl until the last episode. Having learned everything about the nature of magical girls and how they were created from trading one's wish for the responsibility to defeat witches who prey on negativity, witches themselves being magical girls who had slowly fallen to grief, anger, and sorrow. Even after learning all this, this is when Madoka decides that she will become a magical girl, literally in the last episode. And I think it's even a third of the way into the final episode as well. Due to Homura's constant resetting of the timeline with the sole goal of stopping Madoka from becoming a magical girl, because every single time in the timeline when Madoka becomes a magical girl, she ends up dying. And Homura's entire goal is to find a timeline where Madoka does not become a magical girl so that she can stay alive. But her doing this, like resetting the timeline the whole time, had unintentionally made Madoka the most important person in the entire universe, because in this universe that the show takes place in, it's one created by Homura's constant resetting of the timeline. So it had inadvertently made Madoka the most important person in the entire world. So when Madoka takes the trade of becoming a magical girl, her one wish that she gets to trade in for that responsibility is that no magical girl has to ever suffer the pain of becoming a witch. And because she's unintentionally the most important person in the universe, she ends up accomplishing this, destroying her and every other girl's fate of becoming a witch in the end. I said in the previous video that despite the creator's intention, I found the ending of Madoka Magica to be an empowering one. And even after learning these supposed quotes by Gen Urobuchi, I still found it an empowering ending, and it's why I, despite having soured on the franchise a little bit, I still considered the first 12 episodes to be really worth people's time. The ending of Madoka Magica is being told things suck and you can't change it, this is just how things work, you can't do anything to make it better. And instead having the main magical girl say, "How about I do anyway?" Like Sailor Moon in Sailor Moon S, the season Sailor Moon S. In Sailor Moon S, Sailor Moon gets presented with the trolley problem of having to murder a single person who does not want to die in order to save the rest of the world. And just like Sailor Moon, Madoka decides that instead of picking one of two options, both of which are bad, she will just succeed in making sure that nobody, you know, gets the short end of the stick. She creates an entire new option, which other people have been telling her is impossible. And she does it, and she makes things better as a result. She does the impossible and creates a better ending, not only for herself, but for everyone. She ends up saving the world. I liked Madoka Magica a lot. Even though I was aware of the fact that its creator had sexist ideas, I still found Madoka empowering. The creator's words of it being a criticism on girls having ambition soured my feelings a little, but I couldn't deny the fact that I had my own take on the show based on what I felt while I was watching it. And having looked into this further, it seems this wasn't despite Urobuchi's intentions, but actually completely in line with it. Like, much like how Hayao Miyazaki never actually said anime was a mistake, it just seems like girls shouldn't have ambition is one of those things that people quote-unquote know is something the creator said, but if you actually try and look for the source material, you find it just doesn't exist, and you realize they never said that. You know, Hayao Miyazaki never said anime was a mistake. Gen Urobuchi never said that girls shouldn't have ambition. Now, I do not like the glut of magical girls suffering to the delight of a male otaku audience. But that's because I want a return to like those hopeful, empowering stories of girls saving the world and their friends. And I wish we could do that as well as have these dark stories. In a different translation of the same interview with Urobuchi, the interviewer asks,
"But isn't it that humans cannot live without wishing for something?"
And Urobuchi answers,
"Getting back to Al-Qaeda, the desire to lead the world in the right direction is not wrong in itself. Madoka, the main character, made a certain decision at the end, and that was because she did not want to negate what the many magical girls had wished for themselves."
Maho Shoujo Ore is still transphobic. Yuki Yuna is still bad. Magical Girl Raising Project is still hyperviolent and nihilistic, and Magical Girl Sight is still suffer porn. Madoka Magica is the reason this trend of grimdark magical girl shows exist. But if the people creating like the other magical girl shows that turn grimdark, if they looked at Madoka and only focused on the edgy grimdark stuff and nothing else, how much of that is Madoka's fault that its audience wasn't paying attention? Anyway, that's the context for the infamous Gen Urobuchi interview, and where this whole he thinks magical girls should be punished for having ambition comes from is this interview. There's also this part of the interview with Atsuhiro Iwakama, and that I actually found this pretty funny, where he says this.
"There are currently several manga adaptations and spin-offs of Madoka, as well as a novel series. Do you foresee other spin-offs coming out based in the same world? Would you want to animate them?"
"There aren't currently any plans for the spin-offs, no."